八。
Who knows what that is? Not you, Julie, you're ineligible. Who knows what that is? Hi, I'm Marty Cole. Hi, I'm check. You got me? Got it? You didn't hear that just then? You need to go get your hearing checked. There's a miracle ear place that's over by Marianne's Deli. They'll give you a free ear screening. Check. We got it? Who knows what that is when I say hot mic here? Anybody in here know? No. That is a Saturday Night Live sketch from years ago. Anyway. All right. I'm glad that you are here tonight. So here's what we're going to do. Tonight is going to be... Yay, there we go. All right. I'm glad that you are here tonight. We're going to roll through our announcements, and then we will get started. Let's pray real quick. Father, we thank you for being with us tonight. Lord, you knew who was going to be here. You've been waiting on us all day. Lord, I pray that you would help us to lock into what you have for us tonight. Help us to be focused. Help us to receive what the Spirit has to say to the church. We love you, and we thank you for all things. It's in your name we live and we pray. Amen. Watch our announcement slide.
Hey, everybody. I'm Alexandra.
I'm Caroline.
I'm Taylor.
And welcome back to the Stand News.
88 degrees outside.
Feels good.
We're lit. We're happy.
We are lit fire.
What a great Monday, for me at least. We hope that your week is going just as good as ours is. Very splendid. Remember that we have Bible studies all throughout the week. On Mondays, we have Middle School Monday at 6:30. On Tuesdays, we have High School Girls Bible Study at 7:30. On Thursdays, we have High School Boys at 6:30. And Sunday, we have College Age Group at 6:45.
Also, on Sundays, we have Sunday School here in the youth room from 10 to 10:40, or whenever they dismiss you. We also have drama practice, which here's Haley's number if you'd like to join.
Make sure that you text her.
Yeah,
we're going to leave it up for a little bit longer.
We meet from 4 to 6 here in the youth room every Sunday.
We have so much news!
Yay!
An announcement that we missed last week. Drum roll, please. Elijah got his license!
Yay!
Yay, Elijah!
Make sure you go look at his license picture, because I'm sure it's beautiful.
Fantastic. We have, drum roll, please. Trevor took his ACT and got above average in all of his categories.
Woo-hoo! Such a smart Trevor.
And we also have, drumroll please, Mr. Todd's birthday!
Woo! Happy birthday, Todd!
Make sure you tell him happy birthday. Give him a big hug.
A big ol' hug. In the hut, they are selling the Locked In t-shirts for $20 if you would like one. They're still there. They're beautiful, purple, as you can see on the screen. So make sure you go grab yourself one of those.
If you have anything, even if it's minor, or even if you think it's dumb, please let us announce it. We love announcing things.
We love and congratulating you guys.
So these are our numbers. You can send any news to any of us, and we will be sure to get you in the video if you send them on Mondays before 4 p.m.
Can you put that up there?
Make sure that all of your news is in by 4 on Mondays.
Because if they are...
Because if you send it on Tuesdays, if you send it at 5 p.m. on Monday...
All
right. Everybody, bow your heads and close your eyes so we can pray over the offering. Dear God, I thank you for bringing all of us here tonight, and I just pray that you bless this offering and that you bless the band and the sermon that Neil is going to give to us tonight. And I just pray that you let your Spirit be in this service, and we love you so much. Amen.
Amen.
You have 2 minutes to go use the bathroom.
Go to the party, guys. We love you.
Yeah. We're about to have great bloopers.
Yeah.
It's like, do them.
Yay.
I got a free coffee today with my stars. Because I spend so much money at Starbucks. It's not
filming
funny.
For you guys, this zit popped out of nowhere during school.
Where?
Right here on my chin.
One popped on my chin, too.
My skin has been clearing up because I've been taking my drugs.
Todd B-Day.
Awesome. We also have in the hut or whatever. Where are they selling the teachers?
In the hut, probably.
The teachers?
The camisas.
Yep.
Burping so bad.
I'm really good at making.
I'm trying to do it. Look, what did I do?
I don't know.
What is it?
It's just a little flake.
No, it's fine.
Yeah, it is. It's right there.
Okay, okay!
I promise I don't abuse her at home. I don't know why she's acting this way.
Drop my phone, bro. Now I can't get it.
You're fine. You can survive without stabbing your house. Explain it. You know how people like fill in for people during prayer at church? Like I was a fill-in. But
so you were marrying our uncle?
No.
Did you kiss
because
him?
She wasn't no. Yeah. We're Amen. Amen.
Wow. That was so good. If you would stand, come forward and worship with us. My eyes in one.
Haley's been at the doctor this afternoon with ear infections. So thank y'all for plugging away. Didn't get to practice Monday night, and y'all still pulled it off tonight. Kendall done moved to the drums. We needed a drummer. So. And you ain't even mess up. You was worried about me. I'll try. Y'all, I'm telling y'all. I'm praying for Kendall to find it. Well, she's going to have to move to this church, though. But I am so glad that you are here tonight. As you make your way back to your seats, guys, we are having Bible study tomorrow night in here, in this room. Bible study tomorrow night in this room. All right? You got me? All right. First, let me say this real quick. Coach Jackson at Sumter High School with Gamecock Graphics is the man. I mentioned to him, I said, hey, I need a favor. He said, oh, Lord, what do you need? That I don't know why I get that reaction from most of them coaches. But anyway, I said, I got a sermon that I worked on and that I developed, and I got a shirt I want made. He said, God, Neil, come see me. I went up there, and y'all, he made this shirt in like 5 minutes. Y'all know who this is? Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee is the man. There are movies where Bruce Lee is beating up Chuck Norris. So see, Bruce Lee is the man. Well, I developed this book to talk about baseball and Bruce Lee. Baseball and Bruce Lee. Here's the thing about Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee was bullied when he was a kid. Can y'all believe that? Go to that next slide, please. Yeah. Look at that. I hate when they use my body and put somebody else's head on top of it. Wasn't that funny, Larry? Bullied as a kid. They said he started playing baseball just to kind of fit in, to be a part of a team, whatever. So he's into baseball, and then I'll get into the rest of it in just a minute, but a master with a kendo stick. Now, my scripture for tonight is the scripture that every single athlete uses because they can't think of another. Every athlete that plays professional sports of any kind, if you ask them if they're a Christian, they'll tell you yes. All of them. They may have 4 charges of domestic violence and 6 DUIs, but they're all Christian. Ask them all. You know, it's just like, I first want to give props to my Lord and Savior. You know, that kind of, they all do it. You know, the lifestyle don't match the talk, but they all do it. But every single athlete, if you ask them what their favorite verse is, it's going to be one of two verses. It's either going to be John 3:16, because everybody has to learn that when they're a little kid. And the second one is going to be my verse for tonight. Anybody think they know what it is? Philippians 4:13, exactly. See, y'all all knew it. Y'all knew it. Every athlete knows, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And see, where we get this mixed up is that we think when we say I can do all things, it means that we become all powerful. But the phrase that we miss the most in this is through Christ, which means everything about your life for you to be successful is going to have to go through Christ. Why? Because he's the way. Well, in that means sometimes it changes. Here's another misquoted scripture. God will give you the desires of your heart. Does that mean if you want a Lamborghini, he's going to park one in your driveway? No. When it says he'll give you the desires of your heart, that means he plants the desires in you. Not that he grants your desires. And what has happened is we have misunderstood that scripture, and we think we've got a spiritual genie. And we treat Jesus just like Santa Claus. Or actually a vending machine. We think if we put our money in or our time in, I went to church Wednesday, so God, you owe me. And we live our lives this way without realizing that I can do all things through Christ, which means it's got to be through him who strengthens me. Now, all I wanted to do when I was a kid was play professional baseball. It's not as big a deal now, but in the 70s and 80s, you had not arrived in baseball unless your name was on a bat. In fact, people didn't jump on the bandwagon about, well, I need the BR-55 or I need this or I need that or whatever. No, they wanted the bat that had their favorite player's name on it. That's just the way we grew up. I thought I would be set for the major leagues if I could ever get a bat that had Ozzie Smith's name on it. My hero. My two favorite players in baseball are both shortstops. It was Ozzie Smith and Cal Ripken Jr. Ozzie Smith was known as the Wizard of Oz. If you want to see some of the best defensive player to ever play the game, look up that highlight reel. This joker was turning front cartwheels before it was popular. I mean, he was just ungodly on a ball field. And I thought, if I can just get a bat that's got his name on it, I'll hit 400. If I can get a glove that's got Ozzie's name on it, I'll never make an error. Guess what? I can do all things through Ozzie didn't work for Neil. And so I thought, if I could just get my name on a bat, I will have arrived. Through the course of my life, at 31 years of age, of finally getting tired of running from God, I accepted Christ as my Savior and decided I was going to be a youth minister. Been here ever since. What is amazing in that is it didn't pan out for me to play professional baseball and get my name on a bat. But when I started in youth ministry, I got a gift that was given to me. This is straight from the Louisville Slugger plant. I have an official certification with this and everything. You tell me whose name's on that bat. Neil DeBose, that is my signature on this bat. And all of a sudden it hit me. When you decide to do through Christ what Christ has for you to do, all your dreams will come true. It wasn't the way that I wanted. It wasn't for making a difference on a baseball field. But it was making a difference for Christ. So now I've got a bat with my name on it. It stays in the box in plastic because I don't want it getting messed up. But I got a bat. Then I started reading the stories of Bruce Lee because I watched a movie and I'm like, man, wonder who's the greatest karate guy of all time. Everybody thinks, oh, Chuck Norris. And then I'm watching a video clip and I'm watching Bruce Lee beat Chuck Norris's butt. I'm like, what? So then I'm like, man, maybe Bruce Lee's the man. Who is Bruce Lee? Watch this clip.
Into my core, will it be?
two things. Who will hold a flint in their mouth and let me try to strike it with nunchucks? I knew there's one idiot in here. Always one idiot. You would let me swing nunchucks at you. You stupid. Because I would kill you. I don't know that I might not have enough power behind the nunchuck to do anything. Second thing. Huh? Mr. Phil said Joseph and Michael raised their hand. But Mr. Phil said, Julia, hold the flint. I'm about to let you strike it with the nunchucks. No. Julie would hit me on purpose. Second thing, anybody in here can do a two-finger push-up like that? Yeah, I don't know if I can do a two-handed push-up. That joker said, I'm hideous, you see? Y'all like zero body fat. Now, before I get into telling you a little bit more about Bruce Lee, Bruce Lee was a master with kendo sticks. Of course, you see the nunchucks. Anybody play ping pong with... I've seen some of y'all play with the paddles. Ping pong is all about hand-eye coordination. Bobby Richardson, let's just say this, is 80 plus. He'll still whoop your behind on a ping pong table. Because he can just stand and his hand-eye coordination is still good. It's still good. But I thought about baseball and Bruce Lee. So, perception versus reality. Perception versus reality. Perception is, let me hit you with this. No? Let me hit you with this. Y'all, Sunday I did the thing with the Fire Ants baseball team, their church service Sunday morning, and one of them said, let me hit you with that. I thought, here's the way my brain works. Y'all, I love wrestling. And I'm thinking, they hit each other in wrestling with these things all the time. Okay, not on the back, not on my chest, not on my head, but go ahead. Y'all, as soon as he hit me, I lie to you not. Here's what I did. I went, ooh. Ooh, I felt like I was 5 years old and Joyce DeBose was after me with the ping pong paddle. Ooh, that thing hurt. Ah. Ooh, that's all you can do. You ever get hit so hard you get the chicken skin like you're cold? You know what I'm talking about? Where it's just like, that's what happened. I felt like Mr. Mills from 1981 had spanked me at Sumter High School with that paddle. Y'all don't get paddling now. That's what's wrong with y'all. But so I thought, wow. So I start digging in to find out about kendo sticks. Thank you, Jason Capel. These are Jason Capel's. I finally found somebody to beat Jason's butt. Bruce Lee. But here's what's amazing. Perception is, I would much rather be hit with a little old kendo stick. These things are, they look at them. They're like, I would much rather be hit with this than this. But then I thought about, you know what? This right here is rigid. This isn't. This right here, I've watched many of them get broke or cracked. You got a pitcher throwing a ball at you 90 plus mile an hour. You hit it just right on this mixture of birch and ash that Louisville Slugger uses in their custom-made bats. It's going to break. They break them all the time. This does not break. You can hit them. You can hit that pole. You can hit anything you want to. Kendo sticks do not break. Jason Capel said, you can hit them with anything. Here, let's hold it. Let me hit it. No. You'll be broke my wrist, me just holding you, hitting it. And Jason Capel, you don't want to fight me? No, Jason, if you and I get into it, I'm just going to shoot you. I'm telling you right now. Me and you are not fighting. We're not fighting. Jason Capel has a black belt. We're not fighting. I have a bullet. It's just different. I'm not fighting Jason Capel. And I've told you, I'll shoot you, Jason. But I thought, how in the world? Y'all know I love wrestling, and I watched him all the time. We got bamboo growing in our backyard because we had Mr. Phil will tell you, we had some neighbors that lived on the other side of us that I really think that was an altar, that they were sacrificing small children back there in that corner. Because it was weird. I'm not joking. There's bamboo growing everywhere. They had like some kind of long vegetables growing. And it was Thanksgiving, wasn't it? We were out in the yard. Me and Mr. Phil's out in the yard. And we hear, whack, 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 whack. It's Thanksgiving, huh? It was Easter. It was Easter. And all of a sudden we hear, whack, 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 whack. Oh, they done killed that duck in the yard. Mr. Phil goes, know what they having? And I mean, they grow all kinds of stuff, so there's bamboo growing. So I cut a piece of bamboo before it hit me. Y'all, all my ideas hit me at the last minute. That's why this shirt did. But anyway, when Jason brought them to me, I'm like, now this is just made out of that little old bamboo that I cut in the yard. And it's just in little slats, held together with cords. Huh. So I thought about our life as bamboo. Bruce Lee. What do we know about Bruce Lee? You saw the video. Bruce Lee's nickname, anybody know what it was? The Dragon. The Dragon. He was born in San Francisco on November the 27th, 1940. In Chinatown. His birth name was Lee Wan Fan. He was born in the United States while his father was a Cantonese opera star. Y'all, that just don't go together, does it? You are like, in fact, you can go Google this. You can Google MMA artists and look at all of their interviews. Anybody watch MMA? Walker loves UFC or whatever. He wanted me to buy tickets to Las Vegas so we could go to the UFC 300. He was looking up prices and everything online. Dad, we can fly for that. Yeah. Then how much are the tickets to this thing? But every single one of them, when you ask them, who did you patter it? Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee. Now the moderns don't have a clue who he is, but their hero is the one whose hero was Bruce Lee. So you look at that and you're like, oh, my hero's a guy that does this, but what does your dad do for a living? He's an opera star. That's not as intimidating, but anyway, he was on tour in America Bruce Lee's born. His American birth, Bruce Lee's formative years were primarily spent in Hong Kong. His birth under the dragon sign during the hour of the dragon, which was 6 and 8 a.m., that's where his nickname, Little Dragon, came from. Boy, you want to talk about prophecy? There's power in a name. There's power in a name. Everybody's name in here means something. If you don't believe it, I could go ask your friends. I could say your name. Give me one word and say your name. What would they say about you? That wasn't a good response. Would they say, Lord, that's a mean person? Or would they say, she's so nice? Or would they say, they go to church? They a Christian? Uh-uh, ain't no way. Or would they say, whiny, big old baby? What would they say about you? Want to talk about somebody living out the name that's been given to you? So his nickname, Little Dragon, just kind of stuck, and it was a description of his life. He had a fiery spirit, incredible strength, and a tenacious commitment to mastering martial arts, all of which echo the power and ambition of the dragon. Let me tell y'all something else about Bruce Lee. I didn't put this part down, but this joker was kicked out of so many schools it wasn't even funny. He was unruly at best. So what happened with martial arts? It gave him discipline. And I was talking with Jason. Martial arts is about discipline. And everybody's like, man, I want to be a black belt so I can whoop somebody's butt. And that's what they want to get it for. That's not what it's about. When you are so good at what you do, and you've mastered like every single martial arts there is, y'all, there's so many, it's unbelievable. I was blown away. You know, we just say karate, you know, what's all that karate stuff? Karate's actually a style. It's not, then there's like jujitsu, taekwondo, there's all these different kinds. But when you are so good at what you do and you merge all those together that they create a style and it's after you. He invented his own style of martial arts. You the man when you start getting to that level. Jeet Kune Do is what they call it. I had to Google the pronunciation about 4 times to figure out what it was. And it's actually known globally. And it was established by Bruce Lee in 1967. The year Julie was born. After completing a single Green Hornet, Mr. Field, y'all remember the Green Hornet used to come on TV? Y'all have no clue about this. Bruce Lee was Kato. What? Kato. He found himself unemployed because he got fired after the first season for being unruly. He determined to continue his journey in martial arts, and that's when he created an institute for martial arts. The dojo was born. This man has been responsible for everything known out of martial arts since then. He faced racial discrimination, numerous challenges, but he embraced all of those styles. And when asked, what did he think? He said, my life is like a kendo stick. Indestructible. So I thought, what are some things about the kendo stick that we can actually incorporate into our life? So we know that baseball is what gave him his hand-eye coordination and set him on his track, learning discipline, gave him a place to belong, which led him to the kendo stick. I really do want to hit somebody when he's so bad just to see what. Anyway, here's the first thing we know, first point about a kendo stick. It is adaptable, meaning what? It will bend to reach the muscles or the fat across your back. In other words, when you get hit across the back, see this? It's going to give. It's adaptable. It's going to hit every muscle and bruise you from the inside out. Life is going to do you the same way. I feel sorry for you if you're growing up in a house where you babied and your mom and daddy think you perfect because, woo-wee, boy. You get out in the real world and life smacks you in the mouth and you're like, oh my goodness. You better realize Jesus is more important than your mom and your daddy. And your employer and anybody else in your life. I don't know how people make it to this day and age without Jesus. I'm just being serious. Even with a tribe as big as this in this room right here. Lord, if we don't have Jesus in this, can I tell y'all something? I'm about tired of shootings and killings in Sumter. 2 this weekend. One of them's a former football player from Sumter High. Y'all, that stuff gets my heart. Man, when's it gonna stop? But what has happened is we've become so rigid as the church world that we gotta realize we gotta adapt. We have to realize our life is adapting to what it gives us. Everything ain't going to be perfect. What do we do with those things? What do we do when we've made a mistake? What do we do when we got a bad hand that's been dealt to us? Well, you just don't know what I've been through. There's nothing new under the sun. Whatever you're going through right now, somebody's been there. Hear me. Anxiety is not a new thing. I can give you example after example, all the way back to the Old Testament, about people struggling with anxiety. How do we deal with that? You've got to be adaptable. See, Bruce Lee incorporated a martial arts variety into his styles. Learning different. This kendo stick, it's adaptable. That's why it don't break. You can take a bamboo and bend it all the way over. And you know what it'll do? It'll bend, but it's not going to break. This is what we have to do in our life. Listen to me. The devil is trying to break you every way he can. He's after you. He knows where you are too. We love to know Jesus knows my name, and he does. Jesus knows where I am, and he does, but so does the devil. Where's your biblical reference for that? As soon as Jesus come up from being baptized, you know who the first person was that met him? The devil. Ho, come with me. And what does he do? Tries to start tempting. The devil knows where you are. He knows your weaknesses. And he's going to use those to the best of his ability to take you out. You know why? Because in reality, he's scared of you. In reality, he knows the potential inside of you too. Y'all, there's youth pastors in this room that you'll do the job I'm doing 10 times better than I ever thought about doing. All you have to do is say yes. There's music pastors in this room that all you got to do is say yes. And y'all can make Julia unemployed. There's children's pastors in this room. The next Pastor Sims is in this room. I would say the next Joe Biden's in this room, but y'all already smarter than he is. So here's the deal. Stop being so rigid and saying, this is it. Be adaptable. Y'all, there's nothing any scarier. Is that a word? Or more scary? Scary is a word. Okay. Good. Then being 31 years of age, having a steady job with retirement and insurance and everything, of God telling you, that season of your life's ended. Now you're going to work for the church. And you can ask Julie. I was already doing it part-time. But to give it up full-time, God impressed me. You're going to be doing this full-time. And when the pastor says, I should have brought him in here to tell you this story. Well, here's what we can do. We don't have enough money but to pay you for 6 months. That's it. After that, I don't know what we... Mr. Field, you were on the council when that happened. But I don't know what we'll do after that. My response was, well, I know what God told me. I want to do it here because this is my home church and I believe in this church and this is my hometown. But I can promise you, if I don't do it here, I'm going to do it somewhere. Y'all, that was July of 99. I ain't missed a paycheck. When you become adaptable and you say, God, wherever, I want to be like a kendo stick. Then what do? Second point is you cultivate resilience. This is a trait that's getting lost. What does it mean to be resilient? Who knows? Who can tell? Being able to get through? Somebody give me what you think resilience is. What does it mean to be resilient? I'll be honest with you. Babies are probably the most resilient creature I've ever seen. Anybody ever had an earache as a grown up? Haley got one right now. See, Haley wants to scream right now. Babies that have an earache and they just be... Some of y'all get hangry and y'all need to be shot. Babies fall down. You ever noticed how a mama's kiss just fixes everything? That baby can be bleeding, got a big old scrape on their knee, and mama kisses it and they stop immediately. My grandmama used to tell me, healing comes in the name of Jesus and his blood and my kisses. My grandmama used to tell me that all the time. So much so that I believed it. That and the aloe vera plant, she thought that cured everything. We used to call it the snot plant because it felt like snot. And grandma would rub it all over everything. You got a headache, she's going to put that on your head. What is that going to do? The aloe vera plant cures it all. Being resilient. Bamboo is the one thing that will withstand every storm. Hurricanes come through. That bamboo's still standing. Big old pine trees. I've seen pine trees fall. Bamboo doesn't. Even when faced with setbacks, storms of life, if you become resilient, you're going to make it. Who is our resilience based in? God, I need you. Because let me tell you something. These friends that you've got in your life right now, that you do everything in your life to just impress them and you give up everything for them or whatever, in 15 years you'll be trying to remember what their last name was. Family? Oh, we family. We're going to be there for all of it. Huh. They'll ditch you too. Can I tell you something? You ain't never had a kendo stick impact your life the way Jesus does when he brings in his resilience. He don't ever leave you or forsake you. You ever got those people that when something really happens, they gone? Y'all, I used to love to fight. I did. It's bad, but I love to fight. But one of my roommates at Lee College was Michael Doble. Michael Doble was like 6'6", 300 pounds, from straight out of Brooklyn, New York. And when I tell you, he was the slick back hair and everything. He was the perfect example of what a mobster should look like. That gold cross around his neck, that black goatee, slick back hair, Jerry curled at the bottom. Ooh, I hope you ain't watching. But anyway, we would go out, man, it'd be like, yeah. Man, it's easy to walk up in somewhere and look at somebody and say, I'm just going to go hit them in the mouth just to fight. Why? Because Michael Doble, give me a high five, mate. Right? He right behind me. I'll never forget me and our other roommate, Shannon Burton and Anthony Boland and Michael, we all went out and we got into this place and we got into a little argument with some guys and I'm in the front. I got a big mouth. I know that. I'm talking all kind of trash. Come on, so let's go. Come on, come on. Turn around. Where they at? They done eased out the door. Y'all, I ain't never run so fast in my life. I was gone. You ever been in a situation where you banking on somebody that they're going to be there through thick or thin, and you turn around and they gone? I got your back. Way back. Like at home back. Call me if you need me. Send you straight to voicemail. It's not the way Jesus works. But the thing is, the resilience he offers you is through him. Meaning what? You can do all things as long as it's through him. And when you do things through him, you're doing things the right way. So the first thing we know is we need to be adaptable. We need to embrace adaptability. Then we need to cultivate resilience. And the last point is this, maximize your potential. Maximize your potential. See, a baseball player maximizes their potential through practice and dedication. Meaning what? Y'all, it's been a long time. I believe I can still hit. In fact, I know I can because I've done it. My problem is that running to first base now. It just, whoo, that 90 feet seems a whole lot further now than it used to. In fact, that's what I was telling the preacher a while ago. We were talking about how the softball team blew it last night. Anyway. Losing by one and then in one inning getting spanked by what, 13, 12? Huh? Here's the deal. My name's on this bat. I'm certified by Louisville Slugger. But somehow, even my name being on this bat doesn't give me the potential that a Bryce Harper has with this same bat in his hand. I know most of y'all have no clue who Bryce Harper is. Look him up. He's one of the best hitters in baseball right now. And his paycheck validates that. Much so. So I thought, man, some of you in here have been given so many gifts and talents. What are you doing with those? What do you do with them? Sometimes all it takes is just saying yes. Y'all, let me just tell you this. I stinking love Kendall Melton. Kendall Melton is, y'all don't hear him talk much. Actually, the four right there over, y'all don't hear him talk much. The rest of us, y'all, Kendall's funny. But here's the deal. When I asked Kendall, hey, do you mind moving the drums? It was no excuses. It was no, none, no. You know what? Well, I'll try. You did a good job tonight, boy. I'm glad you tried. Sometimes the potential's not being the best at what it is. It's just being available. And sometimes you just have to say, God, nobody's doing it. I'll do it. What do you need? What do you need? There's nothing any more rewarding than filling a spot that nobody's in. Doesn't mean you can do that well. Y'all, I worked in the TV ministry here for a long time. A guy by the name of Don Arbor was actually doing it. And Don Odom recruited me to help run a camera. Me and Morgan Todd used to run cameras for a church. Mean about that. That's funny. Had no clue what we were doing. This is the day and age before editing equipment. Every Thursday night, beginning at 6 o'clock, we would record. And it was an hour program. If you are on minute 58 and you mess up, you have to start all over. Now they can just say, pause it and go back and pick up where you were. And you can splice it in and edit and do all this. Not then. You had to start all over. Y'all, there's been a many of 1, 2, 3 o'clock in the morning. You want to talk about something irritating and funny all at the same time? Let it be at 11 o'clock. And I'll never forget this. Mr. Buddy Griffin and Miss Simmons. What was her name? I can't remember her name for nothing. Marie. Miss Marie Simmons, which to me, she was like 110 then. And Buddy Griffith were hosting. I'm the host, he the host, we the co-host. What we do? We all together, huh? And they would laugh. But there's nothing about, we got plywood across the pews with those cameras, them big 500-pound cameras, not like they got now, up on a thing, and Morgan standing up on the plywood. I'm on the other side of the church on the plywood, and we just, you know, if y'all don't know Morgan, y'all think I'm bad. Morgan Todd, woo, Lord help. Anyway, I'm looking, we're like almost done. And all of a sudden, Sister Simmons gets real tickled. We don't even know what happened. She just starts laughing. And I'm looking at Morgan, oh, God, please shut up, please shut up, please shut up, because it's already 10 o'clock. Cut! Start all over. Y'all, there's a many a time I thought, I ain't doing this no more. And then Don Arbor says, well, if you don't do it, we don't have anybody to do it. But I'm not good at this. You've been fussing at me all night. Because I can't focus. Follow them. They're moving. Somebody's singing. Because things catch my eye when they do. When y'all turn, I learned that I wasn't real good at just turning my head. It was like the whole camera would turn. You're on live. Oh, sorry. And I thought, man. But here's what Don Odom told me in that. It's not about being good at what you do. It's about being available. So what's your potential? Doesn't mean you're great at that. Some of you in here have an encouraging spirit. Some of you in here, you're prayer warriors. Some of you in here are incredible teachers. You have great thought processes. Why are we not using those? Then the perception versus reality part. I'm winding down. Hang with me for a minute. I thought, which one do I want to get hit with? And like I said, eventually this is going to break. This is never going to break. So do I want to get hit with this? Or do I want to get hit with this every day for the rest of my life? I'd rather take my chances with this because this is going to break eventually. This isn't. Why is this going to be here forever? Same as your spiritual life. Embrace adaptability. Cultivate resilience, maximize your potential. You know what you're good at. You know what you're good at. Don't even try to act like you humble. You know what you're good at. You know what you're not good at. So here's what you need to do. You need to take what you're good at and say, God, how can I incorporate this into the body of Christ? And how can I make the kingdom of God successful? Following the examples of Bruce Lee in baseball, you can unlock your full potential and live a life of purpose and impact. Even if you'll start off the music back there. You want to look. Poor old Jimmy Green has been working himself to death back there. Ethan has jumped back there and tried to help with computer stuff or whatever. And I'll be honest, I've asked God, we need some help back there. Y'all know who shows back up? Shelby. Shelby used to work with computers for the school district. So I was like, hey, do you mind helping? No. So she back there tonight. Look at you. One thing I know, if that stuff messes up and I gotta fix it, we in trouble. The body of Christ will always have somebody before church. Not gonna lie, I was a little bit stressed. Walker sick. I don't know if Haley's gonna be here. What in the world are we gonna do? We got Kendall to move to the drums. We're gonna have Kendall and Larry. And then Taylor and Hannah come in. Haley goes, well, I can play, but I don't know. Taylor, Hannah, y'all did great. You grab a microphone and you sing. Sometimes it's not about being the best singer. I've seen some great singers that God does not use. And then I've seen some that you're like, how in the world is God moving in this? This does not sound that good. It's just the way it works. We're blessed in here to have both. All this tonight to say this. With Christ, all things are possible. What you need to do is say, Christ, I want to go through you. What path do you have me on? Am I going to be a youth pastor? You have no idea how lifting of the spirits it is sometimes, just something so simple. Mandy Ewing posted today that Logan had career day at school. And he told his mom, said, I want to dress up like youth pastor. And she said, Neil, he was going for your look. I'm like, well, I'm embarrassed because I don't look like that. That boy looked cute. Look at him rocking that youth pastor look. Man, how encouraging is that? All it takes sometimes is just a little phone call. I sent Josh Carter a message. Hadn't talked to Josh in a little while. Y'all know Josh. I sent him a message. Hey, man, had you on my heart strong this morning. Just want you to know I love you. I'm praying for you. Dude. My personal life has been under attack like you wouldn't believe. This is right on time. Thank you, God, for burdening my heart. If God has burdened your heart for somebody, please reach out. You have no idea. You might be the lifeline. My challenge to you tonight is this. If there are areas of your life that you need to be a little bit more adaptable in, I'm going to be honest, this is me. There's some things that I've been stretched out of my comfort zone. God, please don't ask me to do that. Y'all ever had that conversation with God? God, please don't make me go pray with him. Resilient? Maybe you whine and complain too easy. How about maximizing potential? Are you giving everything you got to God? I mean, everything you got. And then with what's happening, I want to do this. Have you got a friend that you know beyond a shadow of a doubt does not have a relationship with Christ? Or maybe you've got somebody in your life that you care about very deeply that you know does not have the relationship with Christ. I challenge you tonight. Find you somebody in this room that you believe in their prayers. And you say, I need you to agree with me on something. Because here's what's happening. Nobody in here is Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee might beat up this whole room by himself. But how much easier would it be if Chuck Norris helped him? And what I'm learning more and more is that we're fighting individual battles and all trying to reach the same goal and the same purpose. Y'all, I'm be honest, I'm tired of fighting alone. And what we need to do is we need to establish that relationship with people. Not somebody you want to hang out with all the time. It might not be that person. But I know this. When there's certain things in my life that I need, I know who to call. I need something built. I am not going to do it because it will fall down. Todd, what you doing? If y'all would have seen me building this thing right here. But now if you'd have walked in and watched me helping Todd build this thing right here, you'd be like, dang, Neil know what he's doing. I can hold a board. And see, that's another way you can maximize your potential. Don't try to do something you know you're not gifted and talented to do. If you need some, y'all, this slide, that's a cool looking slide, isn't it? That looks good. Look at the little seams that make the baseball in the middle. And then we got the Bruce Lee in that font. I'm like, that looks good. I told Haley on the couch, I was like, Haley, look what I made. No, I didn't. She said, you didn't have to say no, I didn't. I knew you didn't make that. When I had this whole thought process and everything's doing, I called Bo Madden and I'm like, hey man, listen to this. And I told him, I said, hey, can you make me a slide? Y'all, took him every bit of 10 minutes. This is what he sends back. I'm like, oh. Okay. I don't build slides. Do I, Shelby? Do I, Haley? But when you maximize your potential is you bring those people into your life that's going to help you reach that goal. Some of you need to increase your walk with Christ. Grab some of these seasoned people around here. Might blow your mind the story. In fact, I'm going to tell you this. You want an example on resilience and somebody who's determined to make it to heaven? Go ask Mr. Bobby Christmas to share his story with you. Y'all, Lifetime ain't ever come up with a thriller any more than Mr. Bobby Christmas's life. And the fact that man just is sweeter. I love following Christ. You're like, wow. There's some people been through some stuff. Don't leave here tonight if you've got issues. In fact, we all got issues. But I'm talking about, I need somebody in my life. I told you last week, Miss Sherry's going to start that stuff. Y'all, that's a praying woman. She's mission-minded. She has a missionary heart. I admire people like that. Johnny Houston, I admire that. That's a tough task. Everybody's not called to do that. We're called to help and to serve and to go. But that's not everybody's calling. Everybody's not called to youth ministry. I know that. You don't despise that, but to maximize your potential, you tap into that sometimes. That's why I'm this age doing youth ministry. I'm called to youth. I'm not called to be a senior pastor. Lord, bless Al's him. I don't have patience with adults. I don't. Don't have much patience, period. But please connect. Connect with somebody. That's what makes this so strong. There's four pieces of bamboo here. You know what else it says? We're told that love can be a three-stranded cord that cannot be broken. Because I asked Jason, well, what's all this for? Just to hold the cap on the end and this here, and it's tied together so it makes sure that these don't separate? Oh, I was looking for some deep meaning. It's just that simple. Don't overcomplicate it. Your spiritual life, just make sure we're tied together with love. If you're struggling tonight, you've got something that you say, look, I need prayer. I need help. That's the first category. The second category is if you have a burden, a deep burden for somebody that doesn't know Christ, that you know if God were to come back right now, they're not going. I want you to stand up and make your way up here. You please be ready to pray because I know there's some. It's just a matter of you know what? I'm going to grow up. Don't wait till you're 31. Please. I struggle every day with the amount of years and the days that I wasted. I'm just going to be honest. But sometimes I have to have God. The devil attacks my brain just like he does y'all's. Man, where would I be if I'd have said yes whenever I felt the call? The call's been on me all my life. I just ran. Man, if I'd have said yes earlier, where would I be now? I don't know, but I'm learning that I can do all things through Christ. Doesn't mean it makes me invincible. It means that when I follow His path and through Him, much can be accomplished. This youth ministry is only as successful as you. Not me. You. You need to pray. Don't hesitate anymore. Stand up and come down here. Somebody will meet you. Jesus is already waiting on you. He knows who needs to come. It's just a matter of saying yes.